Our first lesson is from Psalm 133. How very good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head, running down upon the beard, on the beard of Aaron, running down over the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord ordained his blessing, life forevermore. The word of God for the people of God. And our songs of praise are, we bring the sacrifice of praise and remember we're Christians.
Thank you.
because you called us to be your people, very sheep of thine own pasture. We pray rich anointing blessing on both gift and giver. Give you thanks and praise all in Christ's holy name. Amen. Does anybody have a joy they want to share? Okay, turn around and look at the back windows.
Looks pretty. Did
he flip it? Isn't that crazy?
Nice.
When you consider all the rain and all the like duck weather we got last week, isn't it kind of nice to see the sun shining again?
Oh yeah.
It reminds us the Lord is on the throne and trout season has begun. Dawn, did you get anything?
Not yet.
No, I didn't buy it. But I got my lifetime license. Even with a trout stamp. So look out, fishies. Any other joys?
For traveling mercies.
For traveling mercies. Let's remember Diane. Diane is in the hospital.
I just heard from Jen. She isn't coming home today, possibly Monday or Tuesday.
Okay. So let's keep Diane in our prayers and also the family because, you know, what are they going to do without Diane for a couple days? Yeah, she'll have to move in with Jennifer. I'm sorry. But you got to realize, Jennifer doesn't really like dogs, and she was in her office one day when Orion gave her a Slurpee, and he got that tongue right up her nose. And she was very composed. She did not say anything nasty or anything, but you could tell she wasn't happy about a dog kissing. But I laughed. So, any other joys? Okay, let's keep Bonnie in her prayers. I'd ask you to keep the general conference in our prayers. People are preparing to go. And there'll be people coming from all over the world. And of course, a lot at stake this year. But also there's a lot at stake with other things. We've got elections coming up. And I have never seen a more divided America than what we've got today. This ought not to be. We need to start remembering that we're brothers and sisters. We're members of the same country.
Remember my neighbor Bill, he's having severe mental problems.
Okay. Let's keep Bill. And all those mental health issues. The enemy's having a field day right now. Any others? Let's pray. Father God, we do give you thanks and praise for life. We thank you, Lord, for the sun that shines, flowers and bloom. And Lord, for the awareness that you are with us each and every step of the way. We pray a blessing, Lord, upon Diane. We're praying, Lord, that the infection would go away, that the stones would be removed. And Lord, if it is COVID, we're praying, Lord, you would protect those around her. We do lift up, Lord, our denomination. We pray, Lord, as the delegates would meet for the general conference, we're praying, Lord, that you would have not only their heart, but also, Lord, their ear. Remind them, Lord, that we are to be a people of your word, and that is supposed to be foremost in our hearts. We do pray for those that are traveling, lift up bliss in life. We're praying, Lord, you watch over them, but there's others as well. Lift up Bonnie, that she would prepare for these treatments. Pray you watch over and be with her, be with Bill. And all those, Lord, that battle, Lord, just this onslaught of just the mental illness and everything that's all around. We do pray, Lord, for the United States. We lift up our military, particularly those families that are divided by service to country. And we pray we might be one in our Savior and in our Lord. In his name we pray. Amen. Our hymn is page 620, One Bread, One Love. Put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe. Thomas answered him, My Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen yet have come to believe. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The word of God for the people. God? Message is entitled False Security. Don't you wish that you had the money that Americans spend on locks and keys every year in this country? It'd not be enough to wipe out the national debt. At least put a pretty good dent in it, I think. But every year, we put our faith in a little piece of metal that is supposed to make it easier for us to sleep at night. Now, many years ago, I saw a bumper sticker on, actually a couple bumper stickers on the car that belonged to the pastor of the senior pastor of the Ingomar United Methodist Church. I was at the parsonage, I was working, taking some big dead wood out of some of the big oak trees in the front yard at the time. But thinking that bumper stickers like this, one says, no one ever raped a 38. And the other said, never mind the dog, beware the owner. And look what the guy's holding in his hand. A handgun. And his point right at you. Well, thinking that a bumper sticker that, you know, said these sort of things was kind of strange, you know, on the car of a pastor of our church, I, of course, asked the pastor's wife when I handed her, you know, the bill. Whatever I was talking to you about. I guess we didn't bill her, we billed someone else. But she was embarrassed, and she blushed, and she said her son put them on there. Well, it might be true that nobody but a total idiot ever messes with somebody holding a loaded, you know, handgun. But you know something? Like a lot of other people, I've got one of the things in my home. But it's not much for most people to be worried about because it's already overloaded. And besides that, you know, you get arrested for pointing in things at people. Now normally, I have the bullets and the guns locked up in different, like when I had kids in the house, I actually had trigger locks on every one of my guns. And somehow, I don't think most intruders are gonna, you know, wait until I figure out where the keys are for the darn trigger locks and then figure out how to get the bullets unlocked and the gun loaded and everything before they, you know, do what they're already in the house doing. If somebody ever broke into my house in the middle of the night, handgun's probably the last thing I'm gonna reach for. Now, personally, I think a double barrel shotgun would be a little bit more intimidating than, you know, a little handgun point like that in the dark, probably aren't gonna see anyhow. But I probably wouldn't reach for the handgun. I think that sound that a pump shotgun makes is something that most criminals would probably, you know, tuck their tails and run. You know, most guys understand that sound. But I probably wouldn't do that either. That's because they're locked up. But my hunting knives and my compound bows aren't, and so I'd probably go for them because, you know, you can put them in use, you know, just a second's notice. But you know something? Maybe we're missing something. Maybe we should just forget about the guns and bows, knives, and all that sort of thing. Have you ever stopped to consider the power that is available to us from our God? Our God is the one that created the entire universe. I mean, God not only owns the cattle and trees on a thousand hills, God owns all the cattle and all the hills themselves. He owns the rivers, he owns the plains, the mountains, the streams. God owns it all. Truth be told, he owns us too. And not only does God control the weather, the sun, the moon, and the stars, he also keeps this planet spinning perfectly on its axis. You know, he keeps all the stars from falling from the sky. And so instead of trusting in our false sense of security, instead of reaching for a gun that could be turned on us if the intruder ever got the upper hand, A much better place, of course, would be to turn to the one who can save us and protect us from all harm. Have you ever considered how many times God has sent our guardian angels to pull our bacons out of fire? I mean, how many times has a car run out of gas before it ran our way and caused, you know, injury or a threat to life to either us or a member of our family? Our God's an amazing God. Our God is an awesome God. And He cares enough about us that we celebrate the cross. And the cross did not have the final word. But on Easter Sunday, that stone rolled away. In our lesson of the morning, the disciples were all hiding behind the wall. They were hoping, and I'm sure they were praying, they were safe from all that evil that lurked on the outside of that door. And they were hoping and they were praying no one was going to discover where they're hiding. And fearing the same people that had arrested and crucified our Lord, the disciples retreated to the safety of a home, probably figuring that they would just hide behind a locked door for a while, try to wait the danger out. And then when the uproar about Jesus had died down a bit, they'd slip out of Jerusalem and probably back to their old lives. They probably figured once that crisis was over, they could go back to things the way they were. But of course, that wasn't going to happen. Once Jesus touches our lives, we are never going to be the same. And from the moment the Lord Jesus comes into our lives, we, just like the disciples, we become co-heirs of all the promises of God. There is just no place these men could ever hide where they would be out of sight and out of mind of the one true God. Now, if the risen Christ hadn't appeared to these frightened disciples behind those locked doors, if He hadn't calmed their fearful hearts, you have to wonder, what would they have amounted to for the remainder of their life? I mean, they were down. They were disillusioned. They were doubting. And even although some of them had heard about some seeing the risen Christ, Cleopas, he'd be feet back, you know, to Jerusalem after on the road to Emmaus, he encountered the risen Christ, they knew when Jesus broke the bread. But also, you had Mary Magdalene that came to them and said, "I've seen the Lord, He's risen." But they just thought she's a mental case and didn't pay much attention. But the last thing I think any of these disciples were expecting is that this day, this Easter, first day of Easter, would be the day that the Lord would bring greatness out of each and every one of them. And it began when Jesus made Himself known to them. They might have been hiding behind the locked doors with a false sense of security, but suddenly Jesus stood before them and said, "Peace be with you." Now, we know that Jesus' second most common command was to love. To love your neighbor as yourself, I mean, the whole world. To love instead of hate. To love even in the face of persecution and death. But His first command was do not be afraid. But they were afraid. I mean, it was just too much for them, just like sometimes it's too much for us. And so what's He do? He says to them, "Peace be with you." And He showed them His hands and His side. He wanted them to know it really was Him. And John tells us the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Now here's the importance of showing them His hands and His side. The greatest problem I think the disciples as well as us ever have, of course, is a lack of faith. Now you might think, no, it's fear. But when you break fear down to its very essence, basically it's a lack of faith. Faith in ourselves, faith in others, but especially faith in God. And ultimately, the fear that cripples us really is a lack of faith in God. And if we truly were able to completely trust in God and God's love for us, wouldn't we be able to handle anything that comes down the pike? Of course we would. But still, fear is a very powerful emotion. It can cripple cripple us. It can cause us to do things we would never do if we were in our right minds. It can also keep us from being all that we can be in Christ Jesus. The number one problem that causes most of us to make wrong choices is, of course, we're afraid. We're afraid of what our friends are going to think. Afraid of ridicule, afraid of falling, afraid of being hurt. Even the disciples of Jesus, they gave in to fear. Fear comes in many different forms. Lewis Pastor is reported to have such an irrational fear of dirt and infection that he refused to shake hands. I mean, he just wouldn't do it. President and Mrs. Benjamin Harrison were so intimidated by the newfangled electricity installed in the lighthouse that if there weren't any servants around to turn off the lights when it was bedtime, they left the lights on when they went to sleep. It's even said that the Soviet dictator Joseph Stalin was so afraid of somebody, you know, taking him out, that his residence in Moscow had 8 different bedrooms in it, which he would pick to sleep in at random so that no one could get a fix on where we stayed. But because of what Jesus had done in their lives, these simple men, these disciples of our Lord, they would never be the same again. Because now they were disciples of the living God. For when he found them cowering behind the locked doors, he said to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." The disciples at that moment, with the exception of Thomas, who wasn't there, they traded in their false securities for the living faith in Jesus that would never die. And Thomas, when he had the same opportunity to see the risen Lord as the other, you know, 10 had, he also threw away his false securities. All of them threw all abandoned to the wind as they boldly began stepping out in faith. Now together they became a force that transformed this world. And if like the disciples, we can know without a doubt that Jesus truly has risen from the dead, we wouldn't fear anything. Not even death would have its pull on us, would it? For death is actually our entrance into God's fully revealed glory. And if we're a disciple of Jesus Christ, the reality is our day of dying could actually be the happiest day of our lives. But do we actually believe that? I mean, it's easy from the safety of the sanctuary to say, you know, that, hey, you know, I'm not afraid to die. What'd you do if somebody come through that door, you know, with a machine gun or something? Might change our tune a little bit. But in truth, we're not that much different than those disciples on that first Easter Sunday evening. We believe it, but there's still a part of us that's uncertain, it's doubting. Now, we all know about Doubting Thomas. The reality is, Doubting Thomas has a lot of friends in the church at this age and every age. We may not like to acknowledge it, but he does. Now, how many of us spend years of our lives worrying about our finances, worrying about our health, worrying about what people are thinking of us, and worrying about whether they even think of us at all? I mean, if we can only trust our lives to God and truly believe that Jesus Christ did raise from the grave, if we truly believe that our lives are in God's hands, then there's no limit to it. To what God can do in us and through us this day. Now, in our scriptural warning, Jesus breathed on the disciples and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Now, why do they need to receive the Holy Spirit? Well, Jesus was not going to be with them much longer. 40 days later, he sends them in. I mean, there would be days and weeks, months, even years, when he would not be there to reassure them by showing them his hands and his side. They would need to depend on the Holy Spirit, who not only would comfort them, but would also guide them and grant them power from on high. Now, Jesus knew that there were days coming that weren't going to be easy for them. There were going to be days when they were going to be filled with just unbelievable hardship and persecution. You know, most of the disciples were actually called to die for their faith. And without the assurance of Christ's Holy Spirit, they just weren't going to make it. And you know, that's true for us as well, I believe. But because Jesus defeated death, because of the miracle of Easter, we can take courage that we aren't going to be crushed by anything that's going to confront us on the side of death. In Christ, we have won the victory. And so the disciples, they went from being fearful to being some of the most daring people who ever walked this earth. Ridicule wasn't going to deter them, neither torture nor threat of death. She's alive. Don't you dare take her out. We need like the signs of life in this congregation. That sounds like good. That's okay. Can anybody here remember getting a tooth? I'm getting my last one on Tuesday. You probably didn't even know that. But anyway, you go to a dentist and they add teeth, you know, it's obvious. But the disciples went from being scared, hiding at doors, becoming the most bold people on this planet. There was no one that could stop them. And that's why today there's over 1 billion people on this planet that bow at the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Their false security turned into trusting. Their fear was replaced by faith. And as an exercise of their faith, they got out into the streets and they proclaimed the gospel to every corner of the world. Now, what scares you this morning? What's kept you from doing or being all that you want to do? And so this morning, I want to urge you to confess it and claim your victory in Jesus Christ. And then I want to urge you to jump into what remains of this day, because it truly is the first day of the rest of your life. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father God, we do pray for holy boldness. The world out there just keeps knocking and keeps trying to chip away at the foundation upon which your lives are built on. But Lord, you're stronger than they are. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, so are we. So we pray, Lord, that as the church, we might reclaim our place in this world as a beacon of light, a beacon of hope, a beacon of the power of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. In United Methodist Church, I remind you that ours is an open communion, and all are invited to receive of the grace which the Lord does supply and be a part of our Holy Communion. If you can't get back here, up to the altar as the ushers will dismiss, they will bring communion back to you. You'll find this on page 15. It's also up on the screen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God. And so to your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and as a living sacrifice, in union with Christ, offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And may we pray together the prayer he taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. may he rise in peace, recognizing we are a forgiven people. Amen. Fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now, remain with you forever and ever.